Hello, and welcome to my talk, A Dialog About SwiftDialog. This talk aims to serve as an introduction to SwiftDialog, what it can do, and how it might benefit your workflows. My name is Bart Reardon, currently working for the CSIRO in Australia, and I've been here for 20 years, looking after the macOS fleet. First, a brief history of why SwiftDialog exists. SwiftDialog started late one night in March 2021, when I was inspired to write an application to solve an issue that I was experiencing with information presentation to my users. I was inspired by the work that Eric Gomez used on the application Nudge. In that application, he used a SwiftUI as the framework for developing the application, and I decided based off his experience and feedback that I would write my application in SwiftUI as well. Around 3 days later, I had created the first version, which was then called Dialog, and released it to the Mac admin community. My first version had very humble beginnings and did not have a lot of functionality, but the core utility of the application was present, and that was presenting a basic message and dialogue to my user base. Shortly after releasing, I got authorization from my employer to fully open source the application, and this is now available on my GitHub for anyone to use or modify. So what is SwiftDialog, and what is, So what is SwiftDialog, what is it, what does it do, and how does it work? SwiftDialog is a utility app that can be used to display information, get user input, or even trigger custom events all from the command line, or from your own custom scripts that displays macOS dialogs and is intended to be used in a way to present information from management scripts in a user-friendly way. Using arguments on the command line, SwiftDialog is configurable with over 860 different options, supported by macOS 11 or later, and as mentioned, is open sourced with a BSD MIT-based license. An example of how I've used SwiftDialog, this is a example pop-up reminder that I run as a Jamf policy. And this is for a culture survey in my organization, including some basic branding, a simple message with a link in the text, and just a simple close button underneath. Another example highlighting an alternate display style using some basic markdown formatting in the message, which we can get to later, and an overlay icon to give context for the message and descriptive text for the buttons. This is an example of a simple user help workflow using multiple dialogues. This particular was supplied by one of the users of SwiftDialog that has been taking up the opportunity to use this application. And it can also be used in deployment workflows, where SwiftDialog can be used to present ongoing progress of a task and provide rich information context to show progress. So this covers the basic of what SwiftDialog is, but I'd like to just touch on what SwiftDialog isn't. It has no brains of its own. By itself, Dialog doesn't know how to read any logs. It doesn't know what it's being asked to display. And the logic is essentially anything that you can supply via a bash or Python script. In that way, it works very similar to how you would currently use something like Jamf Helper. Dialog brains are whatever it can be supplied by bash script. With that, let's go through some details of how this can be used. So Dialog works by interpreting command line arguments, and these arguments are used to describe the layout of the dialog that you want to show. Command line arguments take the form of an option name with an option argument. All the options that are available are in the built-in documentation, which you can call by using the help argument. There are currently over 60 arguments available for use with modifying SwiftDialog. The layout of a dialog window is fairly simple. There is a title area, an icon area, a message area, which will contain everything concerned with the content of what you're showing, and a button area. These are the four main areas of that we'll be modifying with our dialog commands. For example, if we want to change the title of a dialog, we can use the title argument with the text saying what we want to appear. In this case, welcome to JNUC 2022. Similarly, the message can be updated by calling the message argument with the text you want to display. The example here, I've added a simple demonstration message. Buttons can also be added. There is the ever-present default button, which is hotkeyed to the enter key. But there are two additional buttons, which will act as a cancel button and a information button. Each button returns a different return code when used to dismiss the dialog, which allows your scripts to detect which button was pressed and take action accordingly. The button labels, however, can be modified to say exactly what you want. The size of text contained in a button is not limited, other than it can't exceed the total width of the dialog itself. Text will simply truncate if it's too long. We can also update the icon, which is displayed on the left side of the dialog. This icon takes any image path. As an example, here I've selected the JNUC 2022 logo. The icon be set from a number of sources though. There are a selection of built-in icons, warning, caution, and info. And you can use these in place of supplying your own image. These keywords are simple shortcuts to using Apple SF symbols. You can also enter in any SF symbol name, by name, and there are a number of options to change how they are displayed. You can use an application path, and it will use the icon for that application as an image for the icon. As an example here, system preferences. You can also pass in the name of a system preference pane, and it will use the icon for that. URLs are supported. For example, here, I'm using the Jamf logo direct from the Jamf resource site. There are also icon overlays, which take all the exact same arguments as the icon, and it will display the overlay on the bottom right of the main icon. In this particular example, I'm using the thumbs up SF symbol. So that covers the basics of creating a dialog window, but there are other arguments you can use to make your dialog look even better. You can select a different font, font color, or font size. For example, here we're setting the color and size and name to use in the title area. The message itself supports markdown, which allows for very rich formatting of the message that you wish to present. In this example, you can see I've used markdown to describe a header, paragraphs, and bullet points to present a list of items. Instead of an icon, you could choose to present a banner image, which will stretch along the top section of the dialog window. The message area can also display full-size images with an image caption presented underneath. The image source can come from either local or it can come from URL. Multiple images can be specified, in which case the images will be presented in an image carousel, which can be navigated manually, or you can elect to tell Dialog to auto-progress to the next image after a specified time. SwiftDialog also has the ability to display videos, either locally or from a URL. At this point in time, unfortunately, YouTube videos are not directly supported, but if you can pass in the URL, SwiftDialog will play them. the videos can be set to autoplay as well. Other than formatting the dialog content, you can also change the way the window behaves and looks. You can elect to have the window be relocated to a different part of the screen, or opt for it to be fixed in place. You can have the window remain in a prominent position on top of all other windows. Windows can be of arbitrary size with width and height controls. You can display the window in any of the positions around the outside of the screen, for example, bottom right or middle left. There is also an option to display full screen with a limited set of display options for your message. Or you can select to blur the entire desktop and only display the dialog window. So SwiftDialog's other tricks is it has the ability to accept user input via dropdown lists, checkboxes, and text entry. And there are methods to report the input back to a calling script. Dropdown lists let you create one or more lists of items from which a user can select an option. Checkboxes can be used to allow selection of one or more items. Checkboxes can also be forced to be always checked and can be marked as disabled, as you can see in the option one example on the screenshot. This allows you to present options which are defaults and indicate these to the users. Text entry can take the form of one or more text entry areas, which can be displayed with a prompt text. Or you can set the text field to be required and or provide secure entry. One word of note is that with secure entry, that the text will be present in clear text when returned to the calling script. So be aware of what type of data that you are asking the user to enter into these fields. The data that you collect from these options can be presented back to your calling script in one of two ways. The standard output will simply echo the name of the field and the value that was entered for easier processing, or for easier processing in scripting languages that support it, you can opt to output in JSON format. There are some even more advanced options you can choose with Dialog, including a handy Jamf helper mode and different options for configuring the content that Dialog displays. Jamf helper mode lets you drop a Dialog command in place of an existing script that uses Jamf helper. SwiftDialog will accept the Jamf helper commands, command line options that were used, and it will construct a Dialog using those commands. This is very useful as a starting point for constructing a workflow using SwiftDialog in an existing script. Not all options are mirrored, but for basic notification, it works fairly well. You can also specify any of the command line arguments as properties in a JSON file. And Dialog will read in this file and use the settings there to configure how Dialog appears. This cleans up your script, and if you're using a scripting language such as Python, makes constructing dialogues a lot easier. The JSON takes a form similar to the command line arguments as argument and argument value. One option I haven't shown yet is displaying a list, which is, as you can imagine, is a list of items. Lists have some special properties, which is intended not as a way of getting information from a user, but as a way to present ongoing information, as a list view is purely designed to be updatable. These properties include setting informational statuses and status text in the initial state can be set using a command line arguments or with a simple JSON format. List items can be updated while Dialog is running by sending commands to a command file. In this way, the content that Dialog shows is dynamic, and if running a script with multiple discrete tasks, this is a great way to provide feedback to the user on how those tasks are progressing. This ability to update the content SwiftDialog is displaying is not only limited to lists, though. For example, we can display a progress bar. Now, since a progress bar is intended to show some ongoing task, we can update the progress bar. We can send a simple command to the command file to update what the progress bar looks like. Almost all the SwiftDialog's content is dynamic. So from the title to the message, the icon, even displaying images can all be updated on the fly by sending commands to the command file. This allows you to create a very user-friendly way of showing the progress of a background task. Thank you for listening to my talk and introduction to SwiftDialog. For more information, SwiftDialog has a page on the Jamf Marketplace with links to download as well as documentation. You can also find it on GitHub, where there is a comprehensive wiki which details all of the options that are available, including many more that I didn't have time to show here today. There is a companion repository of SwiftDialog scripts, which contains examples of some workflows that you can use. You can find me hanging out on Jamf Nation or in the SwiftDialog channel on the Mac Admin Slack. Thank you once again.